for the last hour.
Recording is on.
Welcome to Deke's DAO Governance Discussion for May 5th. It's 1500 UTC. I'm starting with the proposal roundup. Mainnet, actually, with a little bit of a lot more proposals than XSize. So we have 7 proposals that are boosted or pending boosting on Mainnet, and actually just 3 on XSize. So for Mainnet, there is the second deposit ETH into swapper XSize. This is the 2 of 2 resubmission of a proposal that we had the ETH transfer problem. The test proposal just went through last night, and the 5 ETH went to the multi-sig with no problems. So this proposal will pass tonight, and we can, I think it's like at late tonight, and then we can move on that tomorrow. And then there's convert and transfer 100 ETH to DXDAO based on XDAI. This is just like a moving of funds. We haven't done this since it's been about 4.5 weeks since the last one. ETH payout worker proposal for Corcus, 2 Omen ETH content ENS domain proposals updates. So 1 for the XDAI domain and 1 for the just regular Omen.eth. And then there is the safe multi-call installation. Which is boosting. I think it'll be boosted in like a couple hours. That actually has a 2-day boosting period. And so, John, I don't know if you want to talk about the safe multi-call and that. We've done some verification yesterday, but this is a big step.
Yeah, sure. I can address it. It's the safe multi-call installation is called it's like the intermediary governance parameters of the 3 multi-call installations that are proposed. It looks like it's been verified because it's boosting. I mean, I took a look at it myself. I encourage other people to go and just follow the instructions on the proposal to actually verify that it's set up correctly with the right parameters and the right whitelist. What it is enabling through the whitelist is the ability to connect with the Gnosis protocol relayer, the swapper liquidity relayer, and also a swapper farming relayer. And you might realize that swapper farming is actually not deployed on mainnet yet, and that is right, it's not deployed, but this relayer could connect to the eventual deployment to enable DXDAO to interact with it in terms of setting up campaigns with rewards that are funded from DXDAO itself, the treasury. So you could imagine something like a DXD campaign for like the DXD ETH pair on mainnet that could be done with that swapper farming relayer. So yeah, super important proposal. Encourage people to take a look. It's going to open up a lot of doors in terms of what we want to do with governance and that we've been anxious to get started. So excited for that one.
And this is a longer proposal time period. So it takes even the boosting time, I think, is 48 hours too. So this is actually boosted, I think, Monday afternoon. And so that it'll just be get it boosted this afternoon. Cool. Moving along, then there is also the DXDAO treasury diversification number 15, ETH to DAI, which I think we'll get to in a sec, but that's the first one of the treasury authorization proposal V2. And then just quickly on XDAI base, there's Augustos contribution work proposal number 1, which is for a single XDAI. And then there's Venki's worker payment for April. And then there's also a proposal to add BUSD to the swapper XDAI token list. So those are all of the outstanding proposals. I don't know if there are any questions, comments, or concerns on those proposals. Okay, and then, yeah, just moving to discussion items. So wanted to talk about the treasury diversification proposal V2, the execution plan, and yeah, and Dave, I guess, had sent the first transaction of that yesterday that is already in the queue. So Dave, if you want to just maybe give a preview of what to expect.
Yeah, sure. So, I mean, we already transferred some funds that were held in the multisig, right? So that was approved in the signal proposal because from the last treasury diversification, we had some funds left over. Give me one second. Yeah, I'll mute the noise in the background. Okay, that should be better. So we already transferred the funds in multisig into USDC, and I've submitted the first proposal for 250 Ether to be moved into DAI. I post a little update on DAO Talk. And the idea is to just retain the limitations imposed by the proposal. So 250 Ether max every 2 days. So we can do two proposals a week, so to speak. And we'll just be filling out the various currencies as we go. And of course, ultimately, the last week of the proposals that we'll send, we'll just adjust the Ether amount dynamically to make sure we reach the 5 million. Of course, that will change all the time depending on the rates. So just try to do 250 twice a week. And then when we're getting close to the 5 million, which should be 2.5 weeks, of course, relying on Ether volatility, the last transactions, we'll just adjust them to make sure we hit our targets correctly and we hit the 5 million more or less. Yeah. And then I don't know how often I'll post. I could post every week just a little update in DAO Talk, show how we're filling up on the various stable coins. So everyone has an overview, but yeah, that's pretty much the plan.
Cool. Any questions, thoughts? And I think the next stage of the authorization proposal, the additional one, is looking for yields. I think we'll talk about the steps are doing that maybe next week.
Yeah, that was the plan. Like next week, go over the yield stuff and see how we can maybe, I believe Compound is the first one we authorize. So just see how we could put some capital into Compound and then later on explore Aave or yield farming. But yeah, I'll post something about that next week as well.
So Compound is added to the multi-core, which is currently pending being connected.
Say that again. It is or it's not one of those. Yeah,
that's the main question. Like, can we actually interact with the Compound contracts with the new multicore?
We could interact with there's the general open one that has the longer period time that we could use to interact with the Compound stuff. If we wanted to shorten that time frame, it would have to be added to the whitelist. Yeah.
And we can you add things to the whitelist through, or is that a whole new scheme to add to the whitelist?
You need to have a whole new scheme, yeah.
So I think what we can do is basically define the next 2-3 weeks which DeFi contracts we want to interact with, and then we sadly need to add a new multi-core scheme.
I think it would be... Yeah, I mean, I think the three that we listed in the proposal were Aave, Compound, and Yearn, and I think those are kind of the first things to start with. Yeah, I mean, I think it's kind of Compound, Aave, and Yearn. In that order.
Yeah, in that order. Yeah, Compound, I would say, is sort of like the closest thing to the risk-free rate in crypto. And then I think Aave is also fairly established. And then, yeah, Urine's a little more risky.
And then, Dave, did you want to give an update on the gas refunds? I saw your post on DAO Talk this morning.
Yeah, sure. So we actually had... a small bug in the code, which actually the redeem contract itself was like becoming eligible to redeem some Ether. So that's been corrected and attributed correctly to the various addresses that actually did redeem. And the contract is already deployed. And I'll be creating a proposal to fund the contract right after this call. So as soon as that proposal passes, the smart contract will also be funded. And then I also posted the gas cost for the multisig, right? But I think this is a little bit less formal, right? Like you guys just, there's the amounts and there's still some Ether left as well in the multisig to refund those.
Yeah, I think of the governance refunds, I think. So this is for the whole quarter, I guess, Q1. And I think the number was 20, 3.4 ETH or 24 ETH. So I don't know if we could say that that's like seven. I mean, obviously, if you get today's numbers, that's, you know, $80,000. At the time, it wasn't $80,000 because we were spending that. But this is a huge chunk of change that we are reimbursing here. But it is over the 3 month period. And then we did, because starting in March, a lot of the, most of the worker proposals had been shifted over. So there's actually a pretty big decline in the gas expenditures there. But even, you know, obviously, whenever we do one of these fund transfer proposals, all of the ENS domain proposals, installing these schemes, there's still a lot of things we're doing on mainnet.
Yeah. I mean, all the treasury stuff coming up will be mainnet, of course. And yeah.
And now gas, though, is respectable. I don't check it as much anymore.
Well, I just deployed the gas refund smart contract, and I think it was actually $600. So somewhat more than expected, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, of course, you should get reimbursed on, I don't know, that contract or the next one. You can put it in.
Oh, yeah. No, of course. But just talking about gas costs in general, yeah.
Okay. Next item is DXD buyback signal proposal. So this was a post that went live, I think, almost a week ago, and a lot of discussion, a lot of people involved, a lot of ins and outs. And so I think this is the kind of first step that we're taking here. And this would be a signal proposal to lay out the intentions of the program, and then that would be followed by execution on that. So I don't know if there's a lot of discussion to be had on this, given we've talked about this a lot, but just wanted to talk about it here and see if there are any other thoughts. I'm hoping to put this into a formal proposal by the end of the day, both on mainnet and I guess XDAI, definitely mainnet. And then assuming that would pass, we would be able to move forward from there. As John said, the multi-call scheme on mainnet is needed to be able to execute the buyback to actually execute the buyback on mainnet, but we could do this sooner on XDAI because the multi-call scheme on XDAI does not have a whitelist. So presumably we could be like, you know, 7 to 8 days away if this signal proposal passes from starting the first buyback on XDAI. Yeah, any thoughts, questions, on the buyback signal proposal and the program?
Yeah. So if we would start the buyback on XDAI, that means we would probably allocate more funds to the XDAI base, right?
Yeah. I mean, there's probably enough working capital to do that now. There's just another 100 ETH going over there right now. So that's like $330,000. There's, I think, about 90 WEF. I could check. I think about 90 WEF. So there would be enough, I think, to execute the like probably 20K, 25K, 30K orders. But we should like replenish it and fund those orders specifically. But that wouldn't be necessarily a holdup in terms of the proposal process where we would have to, I think, wait on a mainnet proposal for the funds to arrive in XDAI. We have, I think, the funds to start that proposal now.
Awesome. I think we should start as soon as possible. Like as soon as we can, as soon as the DEX are ratified it, we should start the buyback.
Yeah. I mean, the only thing I'm thinking on the XDAI is like for the size of the funds, we've calculated like using 25% of ADTV. And I'm wondering maybe that if we're just using on XDAI, maybe we should have a little bit smaller order for that first one. So we were going to do like a 35K order, but maybe it's a 20K or something. But that would come when actually we would submit the order. Do we have a total max amount of value to bridge to XDAI? Yeah. Yeah, the 400 ETH that we've bridged over, the funds we've bridged over to XDAI, you know, we've done for two reasons. One, to fund XDAI base and have it deal with operations, and so we have Those proposals are second to deposit liquidity into Swapper. So for that, we have the multi-sig, the dev multi-sig that will like bridge the assets over and then deposit them into XDXDAO based on XDAI. We can do it on mainnet too using the multi-sig. Are you talking about the bridge or?
Buying tokens and mainnet using the multi-signature.
Yeah, I think we could. I think it would be great for DXDAO itself to execute this. I think it's a pretty cool thing to have that. And I think especially because we can do it on XDAI soon, that will be the first instance. And yeah, and then I think it would probably be only 3 or 4 more days after we would complete the trade on XDAI where we'd be able to complete it on mainnet with the multi-call scheme being installed. So I'm in favor of waiting until that, but yes, we could use the dev multi-sig now to execute the buyback.
Yeah, are these a small amount or anything just to start buying back?
I think I would favor doing that on XDAI where we could get the consensus of the DAO directly involved in it. I mean, I think the multi-sig is sort of a crutch that we're trying to get away from in general, and especially something as, you know, like, I don't know. It's like the buyback's obviously an important decision and an important move by the DAO, so I think it's important that it's being controlled by the DAO directly.
Just something to think about, though. I mean, so if we do put this in proposal today, that'll be 8 days from when it could go. And, you know, if we are doing this on XDAI, one of the fun things about doing proposals on XDAI is we can get majority vote. So it would be really cool if we could set this up and get majority vote on this. And that would obviously speed the timeline up, but it would also kind of be like a big thing. And so I guess that would be like Thursday and Friday of next week would be when those times we could kind of organize. And we would need 2 different proposals, just like we did with the Swapper farming campaign.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it would be great to get that going as soon as we can. There's a side benefit of doing it on XDAI as well, because I think in theory, people might want to do their vesting. I know some people expressed not wanting to do vesting contracts on XDAI because of the potential risk of, you know, XDAI in over a 2-year time frame. But in theory, people who are waiting for the vesting system to be put into place could be getting their DXD on XDAI if they wanted, right, into a lockup contract on XDAI that would not be that expensive to deploy.
And also, I think we're talking about launching a Swapper farming campaign using some DXD, and it would be great to be able to have the buyback actually be able to fund the DXD for the Swapper farming campaign, as otherwise we would have to use like the multi-sig to somehow get DXD from mainnet to XDXDAO. I guess we don't have any French. I think July 14th is like the storming of the Bastille too. So I don't know if that's the best. It's already taken
If we are thinking on chain references, that should be the date of the first proposal ever executed on DXDAO governance. So I don't know when was the date, but
give me 5 minutes, I'll find it right now.
Yeah, well, that's the date on chain birthday of proposal, the first time where a proposal was decided by DXDAO.
I did, this is a short aside, there was some conversation about people looking at like things a year ago, and mostly because the treasury has grown a lot. And I did look at an old video from June 5th of last year, and it's John saying he was up giving an update of the treasury. He said there's 4,800 ETH, and there are discussions already about people wanting to diversify out of ETH because we want to have some stable assets. And so, of course, that was a good decision not to do that. And the number of ETH in the treasury grew a lot after that too. But anyway, Yeah, and the next, similar to the buyback program signal proposal, is a post from John on the DXD token model. So, John, you want to talk about what this post is and what we should be thinking going forward?
Sure. Yeah, I think I was trying to distill some different ideas and conversations that have been getting bounced around a bit lately, and I think one of the driving forces here is the, you know, upcoming launches, for, in my mind at least, is one of the, like, the upcoming launch of Omen Guild and Omen Token. And I mean, even from experience with the DXD launch, it's very important, I think, to have a clear and very concise and clearly communicated picture of how things work. So I think there's sort of this question with product tokens of, like, how is this big picture going to work, right? And so there's a couple ideas in the post. I hope people get a chance to read it. One of the main ideas is to actually retire the bonding curve. I kind of point to a few reasons why we should do that. I mean, I think for one thing, it's not being used effectively today. The buys have been paused. There's no minting anymore. The sell price is lower than the market, and nobody's ever sold on the curve. At least intentionally. I think there was an accidental sell, like, very early on. I felt bad for that person. But because it's not really being used, and there's 2,499 ETH sitting in the buyback reserve, right? So the intention of this ETH, it was 10% of the buys in the curve were set aside into the buyback reserve to support the sell price on the curve, right? So, I mean, it's literally called the buyback reserve, right? And that ETH is just sitting there, like, doing nothing for the DXD holders. And so the main idea here is to change the model. And we already have the example that, you know, Chris was just highlighting about how we're planning to do a DXD buyback. We could basically piggyback on that and change the model to like a buyback. You know, and there's basically, I guess, two ways you could do this: buyback and burn, or buyback and hold. And maybe that's a little bit of a question that could be discussed. And then I think because it's a buyback reserve, it's only natural that that 2,500 ETH, which is worth, I don't know, $8.5 million or so these days, would be dedicated to buying back DXD and supporting the price of DXD as it was always intended to do. And then, like, the second idea is, like, how to handle product tokens. And I think, I don't know, I actually haven't read the Omen post. I haven't had a chance to do that, but I think that it ties into that. But the basic idea would be that DXDAO is issuing these product tokens to benefit the products, to grow the pie, to, you know, help with the brand recognition and growing user communities around these products. And it would issue these tokens to the benefit of itself and the product communities and retain, you know, whatever it thought was a good amount. And we could do a dividend model where people who have the product tokens can stake those tokens. And it's probably going to be in a governance contract that is actually responsible for doing things like setting the protocol fee anyways. And any fees that are collected, a share of those fees could be sent to the staking contract. And the product token holders would be earning their, like, share of the fees by staking, and the portion, like, corresponding to the amount held by the DXDAO treasury would then be sent to DXDAO for the purpose of buying back DXD and either, like, burning or holding it. So that's the basic idea.
Yeah, what is also important is, like, back to the buyback reserve, those ETH, they are basically owned by DXD holders. And if we are actually using that ETH to buy back DXD, we need somehow to, like, either burn the DXD or distribute them to the DXD holders. Like, I don't think those ETH, which we potentially gonna use, should go to, like, the DXDAO treasury.
Yeah, absolutely. Like I said, it's the buyback reserve. Those DXT are not for, I mean, those ETH, sorry, are not for the treasury, right? They were never intended to be in the treasury.
Yeah, now the question is how much DXT do we need? Because we already have 100,000 DXT on a vesting contract that is going to be running, I think, for 3 or 5 years. That is actually right now. So do we really need those DXT? Because in my eye, as a DXT holder, it would be better if we use the buyback reserve to buy it and burn those DXT and remove them from the market. Because there is already a huge amount of DXT on the locking vesting contract that we have that is around somewhere. That represents way more than the DXT that is already circulating.
Yeah, I'm also pro burn because it's simple, and we will potentially go into buy and burn model anyway for all our tokens. And I actually just want to get like fix the total supply of 149 something shitty. Like I want to have a clear number.
Oh, I like that because it's like six. There's like 18 decimals. It's amazing that you could get like one tiny, tiny little bit of DXT.
100K total supply of the new meme.
Yeah. I guess I'm not exactly sure how product tokens, like, because I mean, basically, like, there's the model of like a buy and burn model or whatever. It's always what's funding the buy part of that, right? And so we're talking about the buyback reserve is literally what would be funding this. But in general, it's typically revenue, like new revenue coming in that is funding the buy and then buying that back. And so I guess for product tokens, like how would revenue from the products flow to DXD if not through like the value of the treasury rising? Or I guess like maybe run through, maybe how run through the process of like product revenue leading to.
Yeah, I think Nathan's hitting it on the head here, right? So like with a product, you have fees through the protocol fee. Like eventually there could be a fee on Omen, you know, on the trades or whatnot. That's going to be collected somewhere in a smart contract. And then those fees could be distributed to the product token holders, and DXDAO is going to retain a portion of that. And so those fees could be directed to, and it could be automated, right? It may never actually have to touch the treasury, actually, right? Like it could be done with smart contracts, and those fees could be used to buy off the market and burn GXT.
The fees from, like, I guess because if the product fees burn like Omen token, then DXDAO has a bunch of Omen tokens, so the value of Omen token goes up. And so then, like, when in the value of Omen token going up, burning the GXT?
Yeah, I'm maybe making a couple of steps in my head that I'm not clearly explaining. But so if you imagine a staking contract that can distribute a share of protocol fees to Omen token holders, and say DXDAO retains, I think 70% is the current proposal, right? So say 70% of Omen token is in the DXDAO treasury, 30% is elsewhere and in different people's hands. And, you know, say like, you know, half of whatever, let's say it's all being staked just for sake of argument, right? In that contract, we could set up that staking contract so that it recognizes DXDAO as a special case and splits the share of protocol fees such that, you know, the share for the 30% is just left in that contract to be earned by the stakers, and the 70% of the share that is sent to the staking contract could be redirected to, say, like the Mesa auction contract to buy back DXD. Yeah, that could be another way. So the RF Noob is suggesting, why not just having DXDAO staking all of its 70% Omen token? And maybe Tammy, you'd want to jump in here and feel free. But I think that is a potential technical implementation that would achieve the same thing. I think, yeah, oh, go ahead, Tammy.
We could potentially stake all of the tokens, but there is a, we also want to have the ability to have Omen as its own governance token kind of flourish and be able to self-govern. And there's a bit of a public perspective issue if we, as DXDAO, stake 70% of our tokens in governance, are then basically controlling Omen, and then therefore, how can Omen Guild really turn into real value, and how does the Omen token have value? So, but of course, there we're holding the tokens right now, and we're going to use the tokens and issue them in the future. And I think it's somewhat symbolic, but still important to hold the tokens currently, especially as the guild takes form and grows over time. Like there's like a multitude of things that could happen that, you know, there's a reason why we should have the tokens if there's like some sort of attack vector or something like that. But yeah, we don't actually need to use the tokens to do what John's describing. It can all be done, you know, just on the smart contract level, to pass a fee to a buyback reserve.
Yeah, and the cool thing with that model is it's also like easily applicable to the multi-network product roadmap, right? As soon as you have a guild base, they will be able to earn the fees on that specific network, and everyone is able to like just have their own buy and burn contracts on the specific network, so that will all work out pretty well.
I think everyone agrees with you, Geronimo, but they're not sure why. They're just lulled by the soothed sounds of birds chirping.
You let the birds do the talking. Yeah, whatever you said, it sounded great.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think there are two ways to drive value to a token, either through like promised future cash flows or because that token has a claim on underlying assets. And I think the current DXT model has been about driving value through like fees accrued. But I think if we're switching or kind of as we morph, I think tying the value of DXT to the value of the treasury, I think is like a really important thing. I actually think we can accomplish that by like memeing it there. And that's kind of what we're doing. And we're really doing that through the buyback, is like we're kind of establishing that that standard so the market knows it and we're supporting it. But I think that's an important thing to convey, kind of as like a forward guidance almost.
Would the idea of tying it to the treasury be, I mean, because this was an idea that had been floated a little bit last fall, of, you know, having kind of a unified capital pool where redemptions of the DXT is actually possible. So, I mean, I think in theory that could still eventually be done. Now, obviously, that's a little bit of a heavier lift in terms of the technical implementation because it involves upgrading how the treasury itself works. But yeah.
But I think, like, I mean, this is a huge move away. Like what John's kind of proposing, we're talking about like almost steps 6, 7, 8, 9, but just like there is kind of consensus that I think we want to move from the existing bonding curve contract to a new one. And we want to have that buyback reserve that exists to buy back DXD to do that. And I think that's, we're definitely in agreement, I think, to move in that direction.
Yeah, and one of the things I kind of pointed out was, you know, that to get the 2,499 ETH out of the bonding curve is going to require that the contracts be updated. Obviously, that's going to take, even if it's a relatively simple contract that replaces the bonding curve, there's a process there. It's obviously a very sensitive contract. We're going to be doing a couple audits and a lot of testing, and it's going to take some development work. So what I suggested is that, you know, through a proposal or whatever, there's enough ETH in the treasury to, like, get that buyback moving. I mean, we're already doing a buyback kind of separately, right? So tying that amount into the overall buyback program, I think could just be pursued leveraging the existing funds in the treasury, knowing that once that update is done, those funds would be replenished from the buyback reserve.
The only conflict with that is what Geronimo pointed out, where like we're bringing the DXD into DXDAO with the current buyback, right? And if we use the reserve buyback money, Geronimo's saying that should go like specific to DXD holders, right? A slight difference in where the DXD is being directed.
Yeah, I mean the end result will still be the same. What we just do now is we take the amount of ETH which are sitting in the buyback reserve from our treasury and do the action first and burn the DXD for DXD holders. And yeah, and then we just like take the ETH back into the treasury.
Gotcha.
Yeah, and just if the DXD was tied with the value of the treasury, then DXD holders would feel like DXD that is being bought back is like they're getting too, right? And this is like you look at all of the like Uniswap. Uniswap has billions and billions of dollars of treasury that they're going to deploy. So I do think it's like important that DXDAO has its the DXD component. So I don't know, the burn model I still have.
I agree. I think there's like a mixed option that could also work, where we can do a partial burn and a partial keep for build, because I agree that it would be an issue if we just do a full on buyback and burn everything. Definitely.
I mean, obviously DXDAO was the biggest DXD holder, so it's like it burning that, it makes it like it gives it more percentage. So it's like, I think the difference is probably like it's either like the DAO is getting 70% of the value or like 100% of the value, because it owns, you know, 2/3 of the DXD already. So limiting the supply would benefit it.
But the ETH sitting in the buyback reserve were always meant to be burned, like to buy back DXD and burn those DXD. So I don't think we can't change that contract.
And part of the balanced approach too, because I agree that there is potentially need for DXD in the future for liquidity incentives, et cetera, right? Incentivizing people basically. But part of the balanced approach could be to go back to Augusto's previous proposal of actually burning some of what maybe seems like an excessive amount of DXD slated for the treasury at this point, right? Does the treasury really need 2/3 of the supply? I mean, and if some of the circulating is burned, it'll be even more than that, right? So,
big questions. Probably not solved on this call today, but things we need to be thinking about and considering. And I think we'll be like flowing on after we, you know, get the buyback signal proposal will go, and then we'll execute on that, and there'll be some swapper liquidity. So there will be a lot of things that we need to move forward on this. I do want to keep moving just to keep in mind of time. And so next on the agenda is the DX Ventures grant investment to Opolis. So this is a discussion that's been ongoing for a bit, and I think has been in the forum for the last 8 days and is looking to go to proposal soon. So Tammy or Sky, do you want to introduce the DX Ventures into Opolis grant?
Yeah, I was actually a little late getting on this call because I got distracted updating the post with some relevant information I got from the founder, John from Opolis. So, two things. We definitely had a really, I think, lively and good debate in the actual forum about the first investment option. Currently, what is proposed, of course, and we could change, is $50,000 to Opolis from DXDAO. And $50,000 from contributors that have now been listed in the post. This would be an exchange for tokens, approximately 300,000 tokens for DXDAO. The same amount would be split up, I think, of the approximate five contributors, along with a percent of equity that's really coming in the form of a grant of future tokens upon sale of Opolis to likely the commons. The main, I think we should just generally like open up for any critiques. The only update I have is a positive one, which is good, is that John just let us know that he's now, they've since launching on April 22nd, they've increased from 60 members of the commons to 3,000 members, which is like vastly outblown their projections of having 300 members by the end of 2021. So that's good news. And I think they have some other traction related deals going on with MakerDAO. And then aside from that, we should talk a little bit more just about the viability of the investment and whether or not we want to do the contributor 50,000 investment as well.
And then I believe the RF noob had some discussion in the forum, and I think he is on the call if you wanted to say anything.
Yeah, hi guys. So thank you very much for inviting me here to express the opinion. So to be honest, I have nothing against this Opolis investment. So it seems like a very healthy future company and everything looks good. So my points that I raised in the forum were more about the process here of doing this investment. So I have nothing really against Opolis. It seems a sound thing. So the first thing is that, in crypto, everybody can basically invest on everything, right? So the tokens are divisible. So it's open to everybody. So we don't need to invest through a DAO in general. The exception being when the DAO offers some advantage, right? Like in it is in this case. But because they basically give us better deals than for single persons, right? But I think it's very important then to discuss these advantages with a lot of details, right? So my first impression was that the forum post was very brief in the sense that it was not, the discussion after introduced more details, but my first reaction was that it was too brief because the DXD holders might be interested in this investment, but only if they are really convinced that it's something, such a good opportunity, because generally in crypto, everybody wants to do its own business, right? It's open and we don't need an intermediary basically to do investments. And the second point was that I felt, and I still feel, that there is no enough discussion on the forum. So the discussion is not so lively. So basically we have three or four people, me included, answering. And this, if compared to the large number, 1,600 or something, the holders, I think it's not sufficient to consider it as a healthy discussion, especially because this DXD Ventures was not launched at the very beginning of DXDAO, something more recent. And I don't know if the DXD holders are voting on this, right? Because I think the voting at the moment is in the hands of the rep holders, which is great for development. You're doing a great job, and I have nothing against this rep model. I know it's going to be modified with governance 2.0. But at the moment, I think this investment is only voted by rep holders, right? So I might be mistaken. And other things that I wanted to say, yeah, that's basically everything I wanted to say. I'm a bit puzzled on this 50% involvement by community members. It's great in general potentially to have this, but where was this discussed before announcing it, right? So it seems like an internal discussion that you had internally between rep holders. I don't know if there was an announcement in Twitter or something inviting all DXD holders to join this group or not. But to me, that was, I felt like it was like announced as an internal discussion. And and finally, the last point I have is that it's very difficult to follow these calls. So, these are great. This is the way the DAO works, because it's still a relatively small numbers of people like you that are actively doing work. And you do great by these calls, but it's very difficult for external or just a random DXD holder like me, let's say that maybe now I have time to follow, but in 3 months, maybe I'm busy with my work and I don't have time to spend hours in YouTube following everything. So I think it's very important to have a forum, a paper trail, right? So where, things are, expressed and discussed in details on the forum, as opposed to, you know, giving pointers to the calls or something like this. So these are just my comments. So I have nothing against this investment. $50,000 is not a huge amount for DXDAO, but still I feel it's a bit premature perhaps to go into this, even if it is a great opportunity, I understand this, for the reasons that I explained. So thank you very much for the attention.
I thought you all had a lot of great points, especially expressed on the forum as well. One thing that we actually all discussed amongst ourselves, because the way DX Ventures was formed was kind of, I think once it started with, it became very clear that the amount of research that's involved in deciding whether something's a good investment or not is quite a bit, right? And if we're using other people's, you know, basically money raised through the bonding curve. So one thing that has been discussed, something that Sky set up, was a meeting with some individuals from MetaCartel who could be doing more of a proper, fully fledged deal memo. And I think that could be something that would be really good in the future to include on any post, kind of explaining the viability of anything that DX Ventures wants to get behind, to maybe suss out these bigger questions in a more like thorough but also quick way. Regarding the contributor investment portion, that's something that I think we all need to, I mean, if people have opinions on it, we can either decide to not do the contributor investment any longer, or how do we basically think about opening it up to a wider community? I think that it could cause some issues maybe with like liability and things like that when it's such a risky, high risk environment, that, you know, people might be investing in something they don't realize that there's like really, you know, who knows what the level of return is going to be on it. So there might be some efficacy issues in that as well as a DAO, if we're just opening things up for, you know, and it's also a question of, does the, you know, the individual founder want, you know, basically to be something similar to like a token raise or something like that from the DAO. Maybe they just want to, you know, do like very known entities investing in their first round or seed round of investments. So it'd be good to get others' feedback about that question of contributor investments in projects going forward.
Yeah, just from Tammy and RF New, all really good points on the additional investment. So in general, the idea of, if you go back and look at the history of the discussions around the idea of DX Ventures before it was even DX Ventures, and then the post about the idea of DX Ventures, you will, the way I interpret it, and everyone can have their own interpretation, is it is never outlined as like a professional venture entity arm within DXDAO that's gonna have like full-time professional people looking at it and executing like deals based on like what is the average return expected over the next 5 years of holding this investment, like how VCs and private equity companies look, right? Nowhere does it like outline that kind of like background of it. So the question is like, what is it, right? And I shared in the forum how I interpret it. Other people may have different opinions. I also, like RF Noob, would love if some of the 1600 DXD and other rep holders would also share their ideas and how they think about it in the forum as well. But like, to RF Noob, which is, you're relatively new here, like in general, yeah, a lot of times forum posts, which are really interesting, like get posted and there'll be like a couple discussions, and everyone always hopes that there's more wishes there was more discussion and productive, you know, asynchronous forum public discussions around topics. And a lot of times like people heart it and they're like, oh, sounds like a great idea, I heart that, and then like no one writes anything in more detail. So like increasing the forum answers and questions and what are the doubts, I agree, is like really important to do, and maybe more effective on the forum than in calls, because then anyone, like DXD holders, anyone could just follow it in one forum thread, which is great. So some people, like Chris, does a really good job of putting any topic, and we can start to put like any topic in the forum and have more discussion. And then like to the conflict of interest thing, the only reason why we ever considered adding additional funds into this actual venture opportunity, the only reason is, and we even question Opolis, like, why do you have this mechanism where like the more you invest, the better terms you get? If you would invest 5x the amount of money, you get 25x better numbers, right? And it's like, well, why do you do that? And it's because they're like, oh, we didn't want tons of like small tickets, right? We'd rather have like bigger size tickets. It's just easier and, you know, maybe it's more effective. So the only reason we ever, anyone ever started thinking about like, should we put additional money in to the DX Ventures money, which is the point of DX Ventures, is to use DXDAO's money. The only reason anyone ever mentioned that is to get DXDAO better terms on this investment into Opolis, right? And so the question is, how are we going to get extra money to get better terms for DXDAO? And we talked, should we open it to the like DXDAO community or just DXDAO contributors or DXD holders? And very quickly you get to, if it's like DXD community, that no matter how you look at it, it's a basically the public. So it becomes a public opportunity. And how do you manage a public opportunity of taking money from the public and then giving it to Opolis as a DXDAO, DX Ventures investment? The only way that we came up with is to limit it to, you know, trusted full-time contributors that actually have reputation and get paid by DXDAO on a monthly basis. And that was the proposed thing in the forum. And that was, it was open to those. It was never open to the public for the risk, like liability, legal reasons, like people coming and saying, what did DXDAO get me into? Like those risks alone are like scary, right? And then there's like, is DXDAO supposed to be investing other people's money? Like some, like there's things like DuckDAO and other investment communities which have tokens and they have communities and they have access tokens and things like that. And so DX Ventures has never done any of that and never had a plan to do any of that. So I think that's the main reason why it was was pretty closed, right? And so at this point, it's like, should like those people be able to invest? Maybe, maybe not. Should they be able to vote on the proposal? Even saying, people saying no. So there is a highlighted conflict of interest here, which is really relevant. And so if you had to choose between two options, which is from now on, we just use DXDAO's money for DX Ventures, or we let the entire public come in behind DX Venture investments. If you have to choose between those two, I don't see how you can choose the first one. I don't see how you can choose the second one. I think you would lean towards favoring the first one, which is just use DXDAO's money for its ventures and don't open it to others or the public. And the reasons are like the objective of DX Ventures, the risk that comes along with it, the coordination of doing that, the liability with doing that, the legal part, the legal rules of doing that, and the technical capability to actually be able to handle those payments and get it to where you're moving the money, and then how to distribute the future like returns of that investment. Those things make that a no-go. You cannot open this to the public. So then if the two options are, we should just use DXDAO's money and we should not do any individual contributions. That's my kind of overall summary, but happy to put that in the forum. That's like too detailed, but yeah.
Yeah, I want to maybe chime in here. I think generally you're right. And like, I'll just say that in the case of Opolis, originally I spoke to John and he said like the DXDAO itself doesn't need to manage everyone's funds. Like if I'm investing with a DXDAO, I can transfer the funds directly to Opolis and it will be considered in that kind of, whatever the DXDAO investment. So I don't think that thing is an issue. And I think that like this will be relevant also for future investments. Like just on their books, they will have like multiple addresses that can, that invested basically, each with their, you know, how much they contributed. I would like, I really like the open model, and I don't think that like this is an issue until we have, you know, like 1,000 people who want to invest. The only risk is the legal one. Like, but yeah, that's basically it.
Nylon, like we know how DuckDAO and these communities work. If you say this is open, like anyone can invest in this early round of Opolis, just say that you're with VXDAO and send money from your wallet, and then they get like 100 wallets. You think Opolis wants that?
No. Yeah, I guess I don't think Opolis wants that. And
no way.
That's not how it works. Like, if you want to do it as like DuckDAO and these other groups, DuckDAO is a group investing. So the money is sent to DuckDAO, and then the money is from DuckDAO sent to the company. So it's not each and every person investing. There will never be like individuals investing. And there's many reasons for that. Many projects want KYC, right? And sometimes all you need is one KYC. One person takes the KYC. So that's that.
Yeah, and the Opolis tokens are actually vested. So like overall, I think it was a mistake to include like rep holders and / full-time contributors into the DX Venture project. I think we should actually get rid of that and just have a clean DX Ventures, just putting DXDAO funds, invest basically just from the DXDAO, just to have like a clear, without any conflict of interest, which we have right now. Like, I'm fine with not voting, but that's not something which is scalable, like going forward. I think we should potentially like get rid of the additional funds from the rep holders or full-time members now with Opolis, or that's like the only time, and the next time like this is not gonna happen.
Yeah, or invest 100k, right? So I mean, I don't see if 100k is 4 times as profitable than 50k, then why not? Unless you are doubtful of the soundness of the investment, right?
Yeah. Well, the optimal would be 250k. Like if you do 250k, you get the best optimal percentages and like return.
So if that's the what you think is best, why not proposing this? Huh? But at that point, you know, I think it would make sense to discuss this with DXD holders. And if they do not participate in the forum, perhaps it's better, you know, to wait for governance 2.0, right? So that's my feeling. So this thing seems a bit accelerated to me. I understand that Opolis, the opportunity is now. So I don't mind this investment, just to be clear. But in general, to me, it seems necessarily accelerated compared to many other things that are done very carefully and following, you know, step by step in DXDAO. These things, to me, even a discussion we are having suggests that something to do slowly and perhaps asking DXD holders on chain, basically.
I don't really have a strong opinion on this, but if we do go with 250, I feel like we're also kind of falling into the FOMO marketing trap of Opolis, right?
Yeah, I don't think
250 in my mind is a no-go because that doesn't fit into the whole point of DX Ventures and what's been outlined for DX Ventures to do. So we can't do 250 because that's not what DX Ventures does. We'd have to do like a whole separate request and proposal outside of DX Ventures to do an investment like that.
Yeah, so what we could do is create a snapshot today and ask the DXD holders if they're fine with 100K or like the reduction of 250K without full-time contributors.
So that was a snapshot to do it for 100K? Is that what you said?
Right, like 100K or 50K without contributors.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. We can do that and move forward from there.
Okay. So is the snapshot to DXD holders, which we've experimented with in the past on a few different proposals, is DX Ventures like what makes it specifically that DXD holders we should get the signal proposal from DXD holders versus like spending money for other things from the DAO? Then why shouldn't we get their signal signal feeling every time DXDAO spends money?
Yeah, great question.
Why is it specific to DX Ventures, I guess, is my question.
Great question. Yeah, primarily because a DXD holder right now raised concerns. So that's like one big reason. And like in general, DX Ventures was always meant to be rep holders proposing, but the DXDAO at the end of the day will ratify the proposal, right? So in general, I don't think we should always include snapshot proposals. This is just like a mistake we did, and we just need to get consents from DXD owners.
Yeah, if anything, I think this sets some good precedent for when we are getting some major pushback from a DXD holder about something, we need to move forward until we have governance 2.0 with either a snapshot or some other form of consensus regarding any type of treasury management issue.
And it's probably like a good idea to start getting that signal before we just like flip the switch, for that Gov 2.0. So yeah, I like the idea of incorporating more things into this.
But I would also say that, you know, I'm not actively involved in this effort, but from what I can tell, Sky, Tammy, and others involved have been very diligent with the process. And this is one of the first being done. So I think it makes sense that the process is evolving. And just like a reminder that I think the main mission here is to support pain points that DXDAO has, and Opolis addresses a very important pain point for DXDAO to basically do anything at all by paying people to actually develop and work for a DAO that does not have a legal entity like based somewhere. So I just want to like make sure that those points are clearly understood. If there's a DXD signal vote, that would be great too. I mean, I'd be down with that.
Yeah, it's pretty interesting. Tammy, I think you just recently shared it, but like, I think you mentioned that like Maker planning to use like Opolis. Like Maker is a real DAO. It's like one of the first real DAOs, right? And the fact that they're like, they were an early grant giver, big participant, and they're actually planning to like use Opolis to solve the needs of Maker actual DAO is pretty big signal, which is cool.
Yeah, to clarify,
it's a new proposed communications arm of MakerDAO that's going to be handling all of their like communications and updates, and they will be creating an S corp in order to pay these individuals. And in order to do that, they're thinking about using Opolis in order to deal with all the payroll complexities that come with working with a DAO.
Yeah, it's pure theater.
Hold on. Maker DAO is a real DAO and actually does real stuff, though, right?
We should probably take an action item on the debate on whether Maker is a real DAO. I think we have some strong
opinions. There's a whole Jitsi room for that we can put Geronimo in to discuss Maker DAO. But just on the Opolis, so it sounds like, I guess, is Tammy and Sky going to follow things up from here? And along maybe the lines that Geronimo laid out.
Yeah, so a snapshot, a DXD snapshot, and have two options and only use DX Ventures, DXDAO money.
Yes, right? And we'll do another kind of preface of kind of what's been going on with the traction and the point of DX Ventures and give all that information about, you know, pain points and things like that, like John mentioned, because that is important.
Cool. And I know we're running late here. Just a couple other things. There was Sky had a post in the forum about doing a DXDAO community competition for Omen markets. This is something we'd done a couple months ago, and I think it's something, I think it was only 1500 or 2000 DAI, but it'd be great to see that move to proposal. Yes, Scott. Yeah,
just real quick on that. So we learned from the first one, and I'm going to post, like, you can look at the on-chain like results and all that stuff, but I'm just summarizing it and I'll share that in the forum thread. But my takeaways that I can gather from it was, we need more participants. We need more market submissions. We need better markets. We need more rep holders picking the markets. And then we need rep holders to be better at picking successful markets, because they're the ones voting on this competition. So there were a couple comments about like focusing on getting fewer markets, which I didn't know. Like, in my mind, we need to throw more money at the whole thing to get the attention of the best prediction market people in the world. And if that takes $50,000 to like get the best prediction market people in the world that know the best markets to come join Omen community and make and offer markets, and then teach rep holders how to pick good Omen markets and then fund those, then we should try to do that. But like, yeah, we should increase the amounts, but like, I actually think we need more markets and more participants and we should try to, like, you know, take the first competition and do a second competition with like on steroids and like overspend. And then this is all leading into Omen token and stuff. So like, it can't hurt getting like, if the Defiant says like, oh my God, like DXDAO just made $100,000 like Omen market competition or something. Like, okay, maybe 100,000 is too much, but like just more attention rather than less attention. So like, let's make it big. That's my point, my view.
Yeah, absolutely. I think make it big, brand awareness driving everything. And just as we gave a shout out on Monday's call about Omen, a lot of credit to Caden, who's been like creating a lot of cool markets. And if you follow him on Twitter, he's constantly talking about Omen on Twitter. So a lot of this is just like the daily grind of always thinking about markets, always thinking about what could be good. So anyway, all right, we'll look forward to that. And then Melanie just hopped off the call, but she did get a post up on DAO Talk about DXD tracking. So obviously with the vesting contracts and gas, and then trying to get that settled up with Bottle Rocket, there's been a lot of DXD that has been earned by contributors that has not actually been issued. And so this spreadsheet is meant to be the place that we can track, and is what the bottleneck is really the Bottle Rocket. But we can use this sheet to track to make sure that we've got everything. So please, this is not going on the blockchain yet. You're not going to do your DXD yet, but this will be the basis for what we're going to be using when we need to tie all of this up. So make sure you check that going back. And then also be on the lookout for another sheet like this coming up in the next couple of weeks as it relates to rep awards, because we're going to have to do the same process there. And I think we should start thinking about doing around making some rep awards on mainnet. Once we aggregate all of this data there, we can get clear and update some of the rep awards in the last couple months.
I just want to say something. I totally agree with Sky about upping the ante on the bounty for Omen. I think we should have many categories, and we should also consider promising people Omen token. So they, you know, it's like onboarding someone onto a startup and giving them equity. You know, they have interest in growing this in the future. So if you give them Omen tokens, they won't sell them if they're worth, say, $20. But if they create markets and they, you know, kind of like flower that plant that you've given them and it grows, they'll have an interest in participating further along the line, and you don't have to give them money for that. You know, they'll just be focused on growing their token value.
Yeah. Related to that is, we in general, like, we're like, oh, let's give them DAI, but let's also give them rep, right? And we always, like, if you know what rep is, you're like, yeah, of course you want rep, right? Let's give them rep. But like, the outsiders that don't know what rep is they probably, I agree, rather have Omen token, even though it doesn't exist, than rep. Like, giving them rep, they're like, what the hell is that, right? So,
tokens, who would have thought?
We don't have Omen token yet, so we could give them rep and we can say, you might get some airdrops of Omen tokens if you win too or something.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I must have missed it. Yeah, it's I don't really feel like they need rep. Yeah, good point.
Yeah, but yeah, here I think people think value rep, right?
Yeah, we're just trying to build brand awareness for Omen, though. I think that's the goal. A lot of different ways. Anyway, we're over a bit on time. We did get started a little bit late, but. Scott, if you want to hit the recording, and then probably for the next, we're going to take